Welcome to the presentation. My name is Ayrat Khalimov, and this is a joint work with Leo Exibard and Emmanuel Filiot. Our paper is called Church Synthesis on Register Automata over Infinite Ordered Domains. And we will consider two domains, the domain of natural numbers or the domain of rational numbers. We start by recalling what our Church Synthesis game. There are two players. Adam picks letters from alphabet I and Eve picks a letter from alphabet O. They do it alternately and produce an outcome, which is an infinite sequence of input-output letters. Winning is defined with respect to specification, which is a subset of infinite alternating sequences. And outcome is won by if this sequence belongs to the specification, and otherwise it's won by Adam. Eve wins the game if she has a strategy to pick output letters depending on input letters to win every outcome against every Adam. The Church Synthesis problem was introduced by Church in 62 and later solved by Buchel and Weber and Rabin in early 70s. They solved it by reducing to zero-sum finite games. They also showed determinacy and finite memoryness. But let us recall why this problem was introduced in the first place. This problem corresponds to the synthesis of systems. And if represents the system, there is some environment, and it's represented by Adam. So environment provides input, and the system responds with outputs. And we want automatically construct such a system given a specification over inputs and outputs. In the original Church Synthesis problem, inputs and outputs are finite alphabets. However, in real life, systems often interact with the environment using infinite alphabets. For example, a system may read a temperature from a temperature sensor, which is a rational number or a natural number. For that reason, we are interested in Church Synthesis games that operate on infinite domains. In this case, Adam and Eve pick values in the domain of natural numbers or rational numbers. And the important question is, what is the specification? Recall that in the classical Boolean case, a specification is a subset of input-output letters, and usually it's considered to be omega regular. There we have a luxury that it can be represented by, for example, deterministic parity automaton, or by monadic second order logic, or by omega regular expressions, and all these formalisms are equivalent. In the case of data specifications, there are many different non-equivalent formalisms. For example, there are data automata, there are variable automata, and there are register automata. There are also different logics. And for the case of register automata, non-deterministic register automata are not equivalent to deterministic register automata, or they are not equivalent to universal register automata. The previous research implies that Church Synthesis games are undecidable for specifications given as non-deterministic register automata. For that reason, in this paper, we focus on the case of deterministic register automata. We now formalize the problem using an example. So, recall that we consider Church Synthesis games in infinite domains, Adam and Eve pick values in natural or rational domains. Specifications are deterministic register automata. And what are deterministic register automata? Here is an example. The automaton has two registers, register R and register R1. So there are states. These box states are Adam states and circle states are Eve states. On the transitions, we have tests, and the test compares the input data with the data stored in the register. And we also have an assignment. The assignment tells what to do with input data. For example, this assignment says store the input data into register R. And on this edge we also have a test which says that the data should be between the values of register R and R1, and there is an empty assignment which means don't update the registers. And we also have an else transitions which are executed when the tests, this test or this test, is not satisfied. A play on this automata is a sequence of configurations. So it starts in the configuration Q0, initial state of the automaton, and both registers are 0. Let's say the first one is the value of R1 and the second is the value of register R. Since we are in the box state, Adam has to choose a data value. He can pick any data value he wants. For example, if Adam picks a value 2, then 2 greater than 0, and therefore this edge is enabled and we can make a transition. Therefore, the configuration is updated to state Q1. And register R1 doesn't change its value, but a register R, because we store the value 2 into register R, it's updated, takes value 2. Now we are in the circle state and the if chooses a value, she can pick any value she wants. For example, she can pick 1. And if she picks 1, then this test is satisfied because R1 is 0. And R is 2. And therefore, the play evolves into state Q2. And the register do not change their value because the assignment is empty here. And so on. The acceptance of a play is defined on vertices. And we consider parity acceptance on vertices. In such games, the strategies of Adam and Eve are mappings from the sequences of data values of the opponent to the next chosen data value. These games are very expressive, and for the case of the domain of natural numbers, such games can simulate two counter machines. And therefore, solving such games is undecidable. And it's easy to see how such games can simulate two counter machines. The idea is that Adam increments while Eve verifies that Adam increments the counter correctly. For example, this gadget shows how to do the increment. Suppose initially the value of the counter C is stored in the register R1, and we ask the Adam to increment the counter. And let's say Adam cheats and doesn't increment the counter correctly. So remember, we start from the value 0, So the current value of the counter is zero, and we ask the Adam to increment the counter, and Adam cheats and says the value should be 2. We store this value into register R, and in the next circle state, if verifies if Adam correctly incremented the counter or not. And we can see that if can provide the value 1, which is between 2 and the previous value of the counter 0. And therefore, because if can go into this state, we know that Adam cheated and didn't correctly increment the counter. Now let's consider what happens when Adam correctly increments the counter and provides the value 1. In this case, if cannot execute this edge because there is nothing between 1 and 0, and therefore she has to take this edge, and if we go take this edge, then it means that Adam correctly incremented the counter. This simulation idea works only for the case of natural numbers. It doesn't work for the case of rational numbers. We now know that it's undecidable to solve church synthesis games on the domain of natural numbers. We focus on one-sided church games. In one-sided church games, if picks values from a finite alphabet, while Adam still picks values from the data domain. The specifications are deterministic one-sided register automata, and therefore they work on sequences of data and a finite alphabet. The strategies change if outputs a letter from the finite alphabet, and therefore Adam reads letters from a finite alphabet. Let's consider an example. In this example of a one-sided game, we have two registers. There is register RAL and RM, and the idea is that register RM will serve as a maximal value and register RL will serve as a last provided value. The alphabet of the if consists of two letters A and B. We start in the initial state 1, and Adam has to provide a value which is greater than the initial value of RM, which is 0, and this value is stored into RM. It will be useful to draw the following diagram. On the y-axis we will have values of the register, and on the x-axis we will have a state, the current state of the game. So the register RM and the register RL, they both start in value 0, and as we have seen in the very first transition, Adam updates value of RM, and I'll tell you that this value RM will not change in the rest of the game, so already now I draw it like this. The value of RM stays constant. And this is in the initial state, and this is state 2. And when if moves from state 2 to 3, she simply picks a letter from the finite alphabet, and therefore registers do not change. So we write state 2 or state 3 here. And register RL doesn't change, so it's still 0. And now we are in state 3. Adam wants to take this edge, of course, because otherwise he will lose. So he has to satisfy this test. And the test says that the value should be between the values of RL and RM, that is somewhere between these values. And afterwards, the value is stored in register RL. So we draw it like this. Adam picks some value, moves into state 4. In state 4, if either can pick B and go into state 5, but then Adam might be able to pick this edge if there is enough space here. And then Adam wins. Therefore, it's better for if to pick this transition. So if moves into state 3. Now we are in state 3 and everything repeats. Adam picks a value between these two values and manages to increase the register value, and then everything repeats again and again and again. So it's state 4, 3, state 4, 3, state 4, 3. You have probably realized now that in the non-dense domain N, this cannot happen forever. And eventually, Adam will have to pick a value which goes beyond register RM, and therefore he will have to move into this state, and then if wins. Therefore, in the domain N, if wins. Just a short note that in the domain of rational numbers, actually Adam wins, because he can always provide a value between two non-equal values and therefore satisfy either this test or this test. Despite being one-sided, such games still exhibit interesting phenomenon and are interesting to study. They can also model synthesis of register transducers, which output data. If you're interested, we invite you to see the paper. What are our results? This is our problem, one-sided games, one-sided games with such strategies. And our results are: first, we show that they're decidable. These games are decidable in exponential time in the number of register of the specification automaton. Second, we show that these games are determined, which means that either if wins or otherwise Adam wins. And finally, we show a property similar to finite memoryness. If Eve wins the game, then her strategy can be implemented by finite state register machines. And finite state here is in quotations, because although strictly speaking such a strategy has infinite number of states, here its description contains only a finite number of states. And how do we show decidability? By reducing to solving omega regular games. In the next slides, we are going to see how to do this. The first step is a reduction to finite arena games. And there will be three insights. Insight number one is a standard idea used to solve problems about register automata. And it's to forget exact data values and instead abstract them and track the relations between the registers and between the input. And so we introduce a so-called feasibility game. A feasibility game is a syntactic view of the original data game, and the syntactic view means the following. You remember this example, and in this example we have tests and assignments and some letters. When we look at this game syntactically, it means that we treat this as letters from a finite alphabet. So the feasibility game is syntactic view of G, but we have a complicated winning condition. If wins the following place. So it's a set of plays such that a sequence of test assignments of that play is feasible. Therefore, the play should satisfy the parity acceptance condition. And remember, we expressed such sequences of tests and assignments using the graphs of relations between the registers. And feasible, such a sequence is feasible, means that it's induced by some data word. So it corresponds to some data word. Such graphs of register relations, we call them constraint sequences. In the paper we show that such a constraint sequence is unfeasible in the domain of natural numbers if and only if one of the following cases hold. Such a sequence have an infinite decreasing chain, and which can be shown, depicted like this. So this is graph of register values, and there is some sequence of values which goes down, down, down at infinitum. And of course, this is impossible to have in N because it's well-founded. Or a constraint sequence is unfeasible if the following holds. There is some value which stays constant, so it doesn't change. And this is a lower bound, this is zero. And there are some register which goes higher, or even higher, or even higher, or even higher, and so on. So there is an unbounded sequence of decreasing or increasing trespassing chains. We call them trespassing because they trespass through this region. So in the paper we construct deterministic max automaton recognizing feasible sequences. We devote the whole section to the study of constraint sequences and feasibility. And this study is inspired by a previous work of Sigufin and Terenchuk, published at STACS in 2011. And it slightly improved upon their work because in their work they construct non-deterministic omega B automata. And non-determinism is really bad for solving games. So we have constructed a feasibility game with a peculiar winning condition which can be expressed by deterministic max automaton. There is a work by Mikolaj Bayanchuk that shows that such games are decidable. Unfortunately, we cannot use their results directly because it won't provide us good complexity results nor a finite memoryness. And also, do we really need such a difficult non-omega regular condition? And the answer is no. What we actually show that we can reduce solving charge synthesis games to solving omega regular games. And this is where insight number 2 comes into play. We show that tracking infinite chains is sufficient. And let me explain what do I mean by that. So we construct a game, a finite arena game, but it's omega regular now. And just like before, it's syntactical view of the register automaton with the following Venian objective. It's a sequence of plays. If the corresponding sequence of test assignments has no infinite chains, then a play should satisfy the parity acceptance condition. And here I need to explain what kind of infinite chains we consider. We consider the following chains. So this is zero value, and there should be no infinite descending chains, nor there should be no infinite increasing or decreasing trespassing chains. So the chains which are bounded from both sides. And previously, here we had unbounded previously, but now only infinite chains we consider. And this is the main theorem. If wins a charge synthesis game over a data domain, if and only if wins this omega regular zero-sum finite arena game. And there are two directions to prove. And this direction is easy. Let's see why this direction is easy. Remember that in charge synthesis game over data domain, if strategies were of the form it reads data and has to output a finite letter, and Adam's strategy was of the form reads a sequence of finite letters and output data, while in the case of finite arena games, we have that if and Adam have the strategies of the form test plus to a finite letter, alphabet letter, and from a sigma star to test. This is for games G, and this is for games reg F. And now you can immediately see why this direction is easy. Because in this case, if simply has less information, she doesn't really see the data, she only sees the test. And even more, Adam doesn't have to provide the real data, Adam has to provide only a test. Therefore, it's harder to solve. Harder for if, and therefore this direction holds. Now consider another more difficult direction. Remember that this is an omega regular game, and therefore it's determined. So what we are going to do, we are going to consider if Adam wins this omega regular game, then we need to prove that Adam wins in a church game with data. And just another reminder, Adam has strategy star to data here and here sigma star to test. And the final reminder, Adam wins in this game means that a play has no infinite chains and play doesn't satisfy the parity acceptance condition. Now we are ready to look into this direction. Proving this direction relies on the third insight. We are going to rely on finite memories of Adam's strategies in Omega regular game. And there are two steps in this proof. The first step is to show that if Adam's strategy is a finite memory, then there exists a uniform bound B on depth of infinite chains. And let me explain what does a uniform bound on depth of such chains means. It means that there exists common bound B on every chain of the form like a decreasing chain or a trespassing increasing chain or decreasing chain. And let's see why this actually holds. Suppose this does not hold. Suppose for every B there exists chain of depth greater than B. So by choosing a large enough value B, we get to the situation where a play with this Adam strategy produces a chain, its depth is greater than B, but because Adam is finite memory, at some point Adam states has to repeat. So this is a standard pumping argument. If Adam states repeat, then what if can do, if can repeat her actions at this point and do this again. But then it means that there is a play where there is an infinite descending chain. But this contradicts the fact that Adam wins in Omega, this Omega regular game, because we get an infinite chain. Now, using this result of existence of a uniform bound, we look into step two. So using uniform bound and strategy of Adam in a finite arena game, we construct a strategy for Adam in the church game, which picks data. And this strategy should win in the original church game. In other words, we need to instantiate tests with data, that is to concretize these tests into data. So suppose a test says that data should be greater than value stored on register R, then what value should Adam provide? Let's say this is current value of R and this is the next value of R. We show that a value should be equal to 2 to the power of b, where b is the current bound. Why is this the case? At this point, we know that any chain, either that goes up or down, we know that its depth is bounded by B. We don't know whether in future the register R will be going up or will be going down, so we need to ensure that there is enough space here and there is enough space here. And that's why there is an exponent 2 to the power of b. To conclude, these two steps allow us to construct a data strategy for Adam given a Boolean strategy for Adam. And therefore, we show this direction. And this is the summary. So we solved one-sided church games with deterministic register automata specifications in the case of natural numbers by reducing it to omega regular game. And the proof relies on three steps, on three insights. The first insight is track relations between the registers. This is a standard insight in the field of register automata, which allows us to reduce data game to a feasibility game. The second insight is we consider an omega regular subset of this feasibility game. And we do it by relaxing the notion of feasibility, and we track only chains which are infinite, infinite descending or infinite increasing trespassing or decreasing trespassing. And finally, the third insight is relied on finite memoryness of omega regular games. These three insights allow us to prove our results, namely that church synthesis game in infinite order data domains are decidable, determined, and finite memory suffices. For more details, we welcome you to read an extended version of the paper available on this link. As a future work, we would like to see more expressive specifications, because deterministic register automata almost contain implementation. And one of the candidates is a universal register automata. And why we consider universal? Because they can express the most important specification, arbiter. Every data request is eventually granted. This is not possible to express using non-deterministic register automata. So we are interested in the bounded synthesis, register transducer synthesis problem, where there is a bound as an input and there is a universal register automata specification, and this bound bounds the number of registers in the transducer that we want to find that realizes specification.